Hello, my name is Maria and I'm going to present the Proxy HPVM, the portable compiler IR for accuracy aware optimizations. So approximate computing is becoming increasingly popular, especially in domains that can accept some computational error and still produce acceptable results. And in our work, we focus on domains that can be expressible through tensor operations. In approximate computing, specific techniques vary and range from software to hardware. In our work, we focus on numerical precision techniques and specifically on floating point with 16-bit wide precision and on hardware accelerators that can expose approximation knobs that can trade accuracy for performance or energy benefits. In particular, we target the Promise accelerator, which is a machine learning accelerator that can achieve energy benefits by performing convolution and matrix multiplication operations in the analog domain. Take as an example the output of this motion blur operation that has been computed with no approximations, and the output of the same computation that has been computed approximately. So you can see the difference in the output quality for these images, but both of these have been computed much faster. So you can see the trade-off between performance and accuracy. In optimizing compilers, one of the key goals is performance portability. And in today's devices, they have been becoming more and more diverse and offering approximation options that expose various approximation knobs with different performance and accuracy trade-offs. And the optimizations that a compiler can perform can either be hardware independent, thereby supporting the portability goal across different hardware targets, or they can be hardware specific, making use of specific optimizations and approximation techniques that are available on the particular hardware target. And the Proxy HPVM system can actually support both. We can do hardware agnostic accuracy tuning, or we can actually make use of hardware specific approximation techniques. And to describe our system at a high level, take an example DNN, in this case LINET, and an example SoC that exposes approximation knobs, which can trade accuracy for performance or energy gains. The user only needs to provide a high level and end-to-end quality metric. In the DNN case, that quality metric can be acceptable inference accuracy loss. So in this case, the user has provided 2 percentage points. That means that for the specified accuracy of 95%, the user was willing to accept for it to drop down to 93% at the worst case. And the Proxy HPVM is responsible for identifying a mapping down to these approximation knobs so that this 93% requirement is respected and the achieved performance and energy benefits are maximized. Proxy HPVM does that by translating this quality metric down to individual tensor operation accuracy constraints, and then mapping these tensor operations to individual compute units and approximation knobs. So in this example, the system has chosen to map the tensor operations of these first layers to some knob of the GPU, and the tensor operations of the last two layers to some knobs of the approximate accelerator. So, as I already discussed, the portability is a desirable property, and in our system to achieve that, the key idea was to decompose the approximation tuning phase into two phases. One phase that happens at development time, and one phase that happens at install time. So before the IR is shipped at development time, we do an accuracy tuning analysis phase ahead of time, which identifies which operations can be approximated. And after the IR is shipped at install time, we have an approximation selection phase that uses the result of the accuracy tuning phase that has already happened. And this phase maps the approximable operations to the knobs that are available right now at hardware. And this way, the AI remains portable and all the hardware-specific choices happen at install time. Now, for this key idea to work, we need an IR that must be portable. And so we base the IR design on the existing HPVM IR. And HPVM is a data flow based IR, which can serve as a targetable IR because it supports compilation down to different hardware targets. And because of this property, Proxy HPVM IR has been developed as an extension of HPVM IR. And Proxy HPVM IR extends the HPVM IR in two ways. The first extension is the introduction of linear algebra tensor operations in the IR. So we include operations such as tensor multiplication, convolution, addition, etc. The main benefit of including these operations specifically as part of the IR is that we can directly map them down to efficient library and hardware implementations. And the second extension to the IR is that we include hardware-independent approximation metrics. These metrics intend to capture the allowable difference between the exact and the approximate output of tensor operations. We use two different error metrics, L1 and L2 error. For L1 error, for example, we define it as the L1 norm of the difference between the approximate and the exact tensor, normalized to the L1 norm of the exact tensor. And similarly, we define the L2 error using L2 norms instead. As an example, here is a convolution 2D layer defined in Keras, and it's equivalent in a proxy HPVM. So it would include data flow nodes that would include tensor intrinsics, one for convolution, addition, and ALU, which are the building blocks of the convolution layer. And also note the existence of the approximation metrics that will be introduced after the accuracy tuning phase. Moving on to the proxy HPVM system workflow. High-level programs compiled in Keras, written in Keras are compiled through the Keras frontend and generate a proxy HPVM IR. The IR, along with the user-provided accuracy threshold, are put through the accuracy tuning phase, which annotates the IR with the approximation metrics. And then the IR can be shipped. Then at install time, when the hardware target is known, in our case, GPU and promise accelerator, we move on to the hardware mapping phase, which performs hardware knob selection. And at this point, when the knobs have been selected, we can move to the code generation. Now let's look at the accuracy tuning phase. This phase, given the end-to-end quality metric provided by the user, assigns error budget to the individual tensor operation, and then adds this budget to the IR level. This phase works by performing a statistical error injection to the output of tensor operations, and then measuring the error tolerance of the individual operations. So in a little more detail, this phase has as input the approximate HPVM program, the threshold provided by the user, and the number of inputs with which to execute the program, which we call the calibration set. And these are provided to the accuracy tuner auto-tuner. The tuner generates candidate configurations. And to do that, to generate a configuration, the auto-tuner basically assigns, for each tensor operation, values to the approximation metrics L1 and L2. And initially, these values might be assigned randomly, but as the search progresses, we will converge to better configurations. And after we have a configuration, we run the proxy program with error injection. What that means is that we execute the program for each input we have in the calibration set. And as the program executes, we add the error to the output of the tensor operations. The error we add is statistical, meaning we will not add the same error every time, and also not the same amount of error will be added to every element of the tensor operation. But the error we add will be proportional to the error values that have been identified by the auto-tuner. So we will insert more error or less error, as we can see here, depending on the configuration that has been generated. And after we complete the execution, we're going to measure the output value, the output accuracy here at the end of the execution. And if this exceeds an appropriate threshold, then the configuration passes in the selected. In any case, we measure the accuracy and we give it back as feedback to the auto tuner to guard the sets. The auto tuner runs for a fixed amount of iterations to select a number of good configurations. Next, we move on to the hardware mapping phase after we have selected the error budgets. Since this is a hardware-aware phase, I'm going to describe our SoC first. We have a CPU, which is used to launch the computation on our accelerators. Our accelerators are a GPU with a floating point 32 and 16 precision. And the promise accelerator, which we described before, it has a swing voltage parameter, which can be configured to 7 different levels. Level P1 is the most aggressive one, the lower voltage level, which introduces the most error, all the way up to 7. The SoC includes a global shared memory, through which all these units can communicate. So the hardware mapping phase works by choosing hardware knobs for all of the tensor operations, given the error budgets that have been computing previously on the accuracy tuning phase. The first step for this phase is to actually compute how much error all the hardware knobs compute, and how much performance and energy gains they can achieve. And we do that by profiling on the hardware. And after profiling, we can compute it every like this. For every knob, in our case, the FP16 knob and the different levels of swing voltage on promise, we compute the error they introduce, performance improvement, and energy reduction. Then we map down for every tensor operation the particular knob by selecting the knob that maximizes the performance and energy benefit while respecting the error budget. So for example, if we look at this convolution operation, it has this error budget. And the only error knob that can respect this budget is this one. Every other will introduce a higher error. If we look at the convolution 2 operation, there is a number of them that will introduce a lower error, from FP16 all the way down to P3. But from all of these ones, we're going to select this knob because it is the one that respects their budget and still maximizes the performance and energy benefits. The final step after selecting the knobs is to actually validate that this configuration after we have chosen the knob still respects the accuracy that we predicted through the auto-tuner. So we have another set of inputs which we call the validation set, and then we validate the accuracy of this configuration by running this on the validation set. Moving on to our evaluation, we want to answer the following questions. What are the performance and energy benefits provided by a proxy HPVM? What is the impact of increasing the error threshold on the achieved benefits? Can we tune for different metrics? And what is the difference between hardware-agnostic tuning and hardware-specific tuning? We use a GPU of an NVIDIA Jetson TX2 board for the GPU experiments and the simulator for the promise accelerator. Our approximation knobs are the FP16 one of the GPU and the 7 different levels of swing voltage on promise. We have 7 different DNNs, FC4, LINET, AlexNet, as well as a variation of AlexNet with one additional layer, ResNet, VG16, MobileNet, and Shallow MobileNet. And we also have image processing pipelines of length 3 or 4, which consists of combination of the following filters: Gaussian, motion blur, sharpen, outline, and emboss. Our baseline is a GPU executing on FP32 precision. And the quality metric for our DNN benchmarks is accuracy inference loss, for which we set 2 thresholds: accuracy inference loss of 1 percentage point and 2 percentage points. And similarly, for the image processing benchmarks, we use PSNR as our quality metrics, for which we also set 2 thresholds: PSNR no less than 30 and no less than 20. So this graph shows the performance improvement for our DNN benchmarks. X-axis is our DNN benchmarks, and Y-axis is the speedup, normalized to the baseline. The red line is the results for the accuracy loss of 1 percentage point, and the blue bar is the loss for 2 percentage points. And in general, for almost all of our abatements, we see significant improvements on speedup, up to 9x for the FC4 benchmark, and with a mean improvement of 2.5x for 1% accuracy loss. The exception is ResNet, which for the specific approximation choices that we have made, we did not find it very amenable to them. We see very similar behavior of the energy improvement. This graph is a similar graph, only the y-axis shows the energy reduction results. With the exception of ResNet, we again see sizable improvements with a mean of 3.1x for the 1% accuracy case, which goes up to 3.x for the 2% case. And moving on to the image benchmarks, again, the x-axis shows the image benchmarks and y-axis shows the energy reduction achieved, with baseline again being the GPU executing on FP32 accuracy. The energy reduction in this case ranges from 18% to 8x. The last experiment I want to discuss is the difference between hardware-agnostic and hardware-specific tuning. Because so far we have discussed that the auto-tuner was searching over error budgets in a hardware-agnostic way, and then the hardware-specific choices were only made in the hardware mapping phase, and this was done with portability in the IR level as a goal. But for this experiment, we actually configure our auto-tuner to search over hardware knobs directly, and we do this in order to measure the penalty of wanting portability. To keep the experiment fair, we allocate the same time budget for the auto tuning time as we did for the hardware agnostic search. So we ran this experiment for the DNN benchmarks, and in the y-axis we show normalized energy. The energy we show is for the hardware agnostic configurations, normalized to the energy achieved by the hardware specific configurations. What we see here is that, on average, the hardware-agnostic tuning is within 15% of the hardware-specific tuning, and there are cases where we're close, and there are cases where we're really far off. The reason this happens is that what usually happens is that the hardware-agnostic tuner makes some different decisions in one or two tensor operations. The cases where we're close is when this layer was not a very important layer. This case would be the case where the wrong decision happened in the most expensive tensor operation of the whole network. And so the takeaway from this slide would be that when absolute performance is the goal, we can support that by actually choosing the hardware-specific tuning. When portability is important, as would be the case in domains where diversity occurs, for example, domains like very diverse devices, that can be supported by choosing the hardware-agnostic tuning, which can actually be within an acceptable amount of the hardware-specific tuning. So to summarize, I have presented approximate PVM, a portable IR compiler system for exploiting approximations, which can provide hardware-agnostic accuracy tuning and the ability to exploit hardware-specific approximation. It has shown to provide significant energy and performance improvements for deep learning and image processing domains.
So thanks for the talk. The question is, do you give any guarantees about the loss in, or you just validated them with the validation set that you had?
So the guarantee is statistical. We actually measure it with 95% confidence level. So actually, there's two reasons for that. One is other people that have experimented with ResNet have been able to improve it with other approximation options. So reason number one is it was not amenable to the specific approximation options that we had. And the reason that happened was that we could not map it down to the promise accelerator, which would give more benefits. And using only the FP16 option that we had, we could not make that perform well when mapping it down to the CUDNN implementation that we were using. So that for that particular case, this implementation would not outperform, would not perform that well compared to the other benchmarks.
Thank you. That's thank you for the argument.